My name is Robert John Langdon, and you're watching my video channel. This video cast is one of my 10-minute shorts, which looks at sites around Britain using LiDAR. In a strange sense, this is my version of landscape archaeology for the 21st century. I hope you enjoy. In our last video, we looked at Durrington Walls in Wiltshire to find that it was not a traditional henge, but a harbour for boats, with natural springs and ditches cut into the site to allow boats to moor in prehistoric times. Today, we look at the associated structure next to the prehistoric harbour, Woodhenge, to see if we can find an association this has with Durrington Walls. This monument has a series of massive wooden post holes. At this point, I need to explain that archaeologists don't seem to understand the difference between a post hole and a stake hole. You use stake holes for posts such as fences, as they can be easily buried into the ground as they have a sharp point at the end. This point naturally compresses the surroundings due to its shape and the hammering from above, so it doesn't move or wobble. A post hole is totally different. It has a flat bottom and needs rubble to stop it rocking from side to side. Stake holes are easy as they are self-burying, while post holes are more work as you need to dig a hole for it. The only reason you would do the extra work of digging a flat bottom hole, especially in chalk, is if the wooden pole had to take some kind of weight from above. For a stake hole, this is useless for this type of construction, as it would sink over time under the weight pushing down on the point and probably falling over. Therefore, if you have a round single-storey building, which was the original theory by archaeologists that excavated Woodhenge, with a simple roof, the use of massive posts is simply over-engineering and time-consuming, especially with simple tools. For why would you want to build something 12 foot high with a piece of wood 6 foot wide? It's just complete nonsense. Now, Cummings' excavations at Woodhenge in 1929 suggested that some of the posts were up to 60 inches in diameter. Clear evidence was obtained in excavation that the 6 centric rings of the holes that once held posts or tree trunks varying from 1 foot to 3 foot in diameter according to the size of the hole. The size and depth and distance varies in each circle. In the outer circle, holes are 6 foot apart from the centre to centre, from 1/2 feet to 2 feet in depth, and from 2 foot to 3 foot in diameter. In the second circle, the holes are larger and further apart, averaging about 4 foot in depth and 3.5 to 4 foot in diameter. The largest of all was those in the third circle, being about 6 foot deep, with a diameter at the top from 4 to 5 feet. Sadly, Woodhenge shows yet another illustration of flawed science in archaeology. Even with a second-rate excavation port from the 1920s, the conclusion of modern archaeologists is that the structure was a single-storey house, a slightly grander feature than the traditional Iron Age house. As I said again, this is just simply nonsense. If you look closely at the evidence presented here, we obtain a totally different and more accurate conclusion to the nature of this structure. Firstly, if we look at the layout of the site, which lacks much detail in the drawings, We can see from the original excavation plan, the scale is understated, as the existing concrete posts on the site are far too small. The most recent photo, which we have obtained from Pollard in 2007, indicates that these posts were at least 5 times larger than the current representations. Although he is happy with the concrete posts they represent, which suggests that either he is towing the traditional archaeological view, or that he should have gone to Specsavers. The next factor that goes unanswered by archaeologists is the reason for the large ramps by the post holes. You don't take time to put 32 ramps into the soil unless it's essential, as you're adding at least a month of building work to the site and 500 more working hours. What archaeologists have missed or failed to mention in their reports is that which direction these ramps were cut, as it tells more than the entire excavation report by Cunnington. We have seen similar ramps at Stonehenge, not for the 4-ton bluestones, but for the sarsen stones that weighed an average of 25 tons. The trilithiums, which also have ramps, they are 35 tons, but half the size of these ramps. A 25-ton pine post with a width between 4 and 5 foot would be 39 meters long, or 128 foot. And a 35-ton pine tree is some 177 feet long. But do pine trees grow that tall? Just down the road from Durrington Walls is Longleat Forest. In the forest, there are pine trees that grow up to 200 foot tall, and that's today. Moreover, the site plan does give us an extra clue on the length of these poles. If you look carefully at the angle of the ramps of these giant post holes, you will notice that they're not all in the same direction. The only logical reason for that to happen is that you need to erect them in a certain order to stop bumping into each other. This allows us to come to some remarkable conclusions about the construction and the process as how it was built. Number one, holes were filled in an anti-clockwise direction, starting at hole one, which is about 4 o'clock to the site. Poles must have been longer than 100 foot long, as otherwise you could have erected them in any old order. Three, the ditch at the current site was added at a later date, as you would need to bring the poles through the ditch, and in some cases, be inside the ditch to erect it. And lastly, the 4 to 5 foot diameter posts all entered the site from the south, as it had the most room available, because if you're dragging 200 foot poles around, then there's only certain directions it could have come from. It clearly, the anvil was from the south, and that would explain probably why the first one was at 4 o'clock rather than 12 o'clock to the site. Now, the ramps of Ring C, the largest posts, are 5 to 8 foot long, which are even longer than Stonehenge ramps, which are only 3 to 4 foot long. This shows that the 13 foot large sarsens require a small leverage factor to pull them up with an A-frame, while the wooden posts need a larger lever factor because of the extra height. Now, interesting, Ring B, the 3.5 to 4 meter trees, also have ramps, but are much smaller, 3 to 4 foot, indicating less leverage and therefore half the weight stroke height of the Ring C. Moreover, they were placed in position after the C-ring, as their ramps point away from the centre with no common direction. The last row of the post holes, A, 1 to 3 foot in diameter, do not have ramps and are sporadic in nature and size, which leads me to believe they have no structural significance and was probably put there more like a palisade. The internal posts, D to F, are superficial and probably were there to support a first floor structure, as we see in their successors in British history, the Brook. Stone versions are very, very similar design to what I would imagine Woodhenge would have looked like in the past. Therefore, what would you build next to a harbour to attract boats? Obvious, isn't it? It was a fire beacon with a stone base, obviously, as we know from our written history of the Pharos of Alexandria in 1280 BCE. How tall was the tower? Well, my money would have been on a ratio of 1 to 1 with the base. Although it could have been a lot higher, as we've seen, because the trees could go up to 200 feet. But just down the river, there is Silbury Hill. And Silbury Hill was, again, a fire beacon. And that was about 130 foot high. So my logic is that something of that height would be able to attract boats from at least 10 to 15 miles round, and therefore makes logical sense to be built next to a harbour. Lastly, is there anything that can actually date Woodhenge? We can see that the waters of the Mesolithic suits it perfectly, but the archaeologists suggest it's Neolithic. Well, if we go back to the Stonehenge in the past, they found burnt pine wood in the Mesolithic pits, which they call totem poles. The interesting factor is that that wood was sent to the same labs as the wood found at the base of Woodhenge, and the soil samples, quote, is similar to the charcoal found at Woodhenge, come from the lab report. Now, we know from the lab report, which was eventually culminated, that the pine wood was Mesolithic and dated at 8100 BCE. One would imagine that is of very similar date and therefore makes logic for the site and surroundings, because just down the road we now found Big Mead or Vespasian's camp, which is also found radiocarbon dates of 7900 BCE, which firmly put the harbour, the fire beacon, into the Mesolithic with the higher water levels of the past. Well, that's all we've got time for this week. Tune in next week for another edition of Langdon Investigates, where we look at another ancient site. Until then, subscribe below to make sure you're informed when new videos come on the video channel. Until then, thank you for watching.